Colin Bird is with me on the line this afternoon from Galileo Resources. Colin, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
An update out today, Colin, on drilling at Star Zinc. Results from three of the first four holes here. You're seeing some decent intersections, are you?
Yeah, I don't think decent's the word. They're very good, you know. When you start seeing that level of zinc, I mean, in the 30s, and with quite reasonable thicknesses, yeah, very good. Very, very, very excited about the results. We did report quite a bunch of holes, but of course we were reporting with the XRF spectrometer, which is an handheld, very sophisticated little piece of device, but of course not regulatory acceptable. So our last announcement gave indication that we're in great. Our previous announcement gave indication that we thought we're in very good material, and of course these assay results have certainly verified that. But as you stand there on the surface, down to 47 meters at one of the holes, I think it's number two, you've got 15.5% of zinc for 47 meters. Now, when we acquired this project, there was never no suggestion that in association with the very high-grade willemite, the zinc mineralization there, there was never any suggestion that it was anything but massive. But we found, associated with the high-grade, big runs of disseminated zinc and zinc silicate and alongside calcite and iron, and this I mean, you know, north surface to 47 meters at 15%. I've yet to see an analysis like that. Our deepest hole is 80 meters, and so that was inclined as well. So probably it's real, you know, in real length vertically, it was probably about 60 meters. So you're looking at quite a results less than 60 meters. And, you know, there was a forecast of, I've done a rock mass calculation, we've done a rock mass calculation, and they were talking 250 to 350,000, which is modest. But, you know, when you start multiplying those by those thicknesses, I'm afraid that, you know, we're looking at something quite a lot bigger. Not afraid, happy to say, we're looking about something quite a lot bigger. And the net effect of that, of course, we're looking at a lot more contained metal.
You're seeing significant germanium and silver values here as well, Colin.
That's right. If you do a back of pack package calculation on the contribution of silver and germanium, they're not very far, you know, and I'm looking at the scoping study, their contribution is not byproduct, it's almost cover the direct operating cost of an operation, and the zinc looks like it might come almost for free. So they're two good additives, silver and germanium, and germanium's coming to the front. It's been as high as $2,400, I think, in the last few months. It's about $2,000 now, and that's a kilogram, we're not talking tons.
Very good. So bring us up to date, Colin. Where are you drilling at the moment?
I think we'll be finishing in a couple of days' time. We went to the east, and really what I'm doing, you know, back to that rock mass calculation, I'm trying to put an envelope around it. You know, is it 400 tons? Is it 600 tons? Is it 1.5 million tons? So, you know, I've done my sort of back of envelope, but this really has to be modeled for thickness, specific gravity. You know, that will give me a definite handle on the envelope. But I think what is important, and there it is in the announcement, is that really all we've done is tested the area around the old void. They call it a pit, but I call it a void. I think it's a collapsed dome. So we've got now available to us. It's still open to the east. And then we've got a minimum of three similar type occurrences in and around this area to test. Now, I was actually going to test them as part of this program. You know, it occurred to us that, you know, if we can get somewhere near 600,000 or 700,000 tons of these sort of grades, that stands for a standalone operation there. And the geophysics, which is pointed as, well, in actual fact, we were pointed by the old shark consolidator program in the 60s, but the geophysics pointed us to gravities, and, you know, gravity highs and gravity lows have both yielded high-grade zinc. So really what we're going to do next, and the association of iron just before the ore body is important. Now the question to be asked is, really you want to identify these, the potential and rank the potential. So what we're going to do is we're going to run geophysics over the actual core. And it may well be that there's resistivity around that lithology, which is just above the mineralization, which would be great. We've really got to get an handle on, is it high grade or is it high or low gravity, which drives the mineralization. And, you know, I'm very excited about the potential for a feeder, a sulfide feeder. And so, again, Do we employ IP geophysics and EM geophysics, IM geophysics? And again, we will basically test for conductivity and resistivity and susceptibility to the electrics. But I'm driven by trying to find the. I'm convinced we stand a very good chance of finding the sulfide feeder, and then we're really in the into the new division.
Am I right in thinking, Colin, this project doesn't yet have a resource?
You know, there isn't a resource at the moment, because it was a, I think what they called it was a conceptual tons and grade. So once I've windowed it, I should be told by the independent modellers where we've got to drill the holes and how many of them to get to measure. But I don't want to go to measure until I've got some idea what the packet looks like. So I didn't answer your question. I'm sorry, I answered the question and say certainly by mid-year we'll have the initial resource estimate. We'll be able to give you a conceptual tons and grades, I think, by the end of March.
In terms of the project itself, Colin, just remind us where it is. It's pretty close to Lusaka, isn't it?
Well, I tell you, in all my career, I've yet to jump off an aeroplane, go for 40 minutes, and I'm on the job, so to speak. Quite a remarkable situation near Lusaka, near Lusaka itself.
And the infrastructure close by, Colin, it's pretty good?
Oh, brilliant. I mean, you're on the main road up to the copper belt. There's power, there's water, no inhibitions at all to progress.
And so for the work that's currently being done at the moment, Colin, you're fully funded for that, are you?
Fully funded. As I say, we're stopping the drill machine now. This program was the best part of, I think, by the time everybody's paid assayers, loggers, geologists, drilling machine. I think we've done about $350,000. But boy, has that been a very big value add to Galileo.
Absolutely. Colin, while I've got you, I just want to throw a couple of questions at you where Bezant Resources is concerned. I know you've recently come on board as executive chairman, invested £400,000 as well. What do you like about Bezant? What attracted you to the company?
Yeah, well, I think that the appointment of executive chairman has got to be the formalities of the Nomad, which I think hopefully are a few days away. So at the moment, I'm an investor. What I like about it is that, you've got three assets, which are pretty widespread, but two of them are, in my opinion, world-class. And it's very rare that you can actually invest in a company with that market capitalization, which in the Philippines has got the best part of 300 million tons, 0.49 copper, and about half a gram of gold. And, that's a valuable combination of metals, good grades, and quite a significant tonnage, and it's still open for drilling. I mean, as I understand it, the last drill hole was an absolute cracker that they drilled. So, and then it's got a valuation framed by the fact that Goldfields has got an offer, I think, for 75 million quid there. So, and because of the ambition of Goldfields to go to Australia and buy a second mine, gold mine, then that the option wasn't exercised. So this is a very nice asset, which needs desktop research and more boreholes, of course, to absolutely fill in the gaps and prove the value. But as I say, it's got a value franked on it by whatever Goldfields decided they were paying, which, as I understand it, was the best $500 million. It's got a York resource, and it's got room to expand, and it's in commodities, copper, gold, which are seriously looked. People are seriously looking for at the top end, and this is a top of the market project, big company project. And then I look at the Eureka project in Argentina, and I see comments of 50 million ton. I see comments, and I'm talking public arena now, 50 million ton, 60 million ton, and that we're talking 1% copper near surface, which leaches well, again. That starting life off with 600,000 tons of copper, which is again a world-class quantity of copper, and it's not even been touched in terms of real exploration. There's a lot more to be done. There's the sulfides below. what's driving the mineralization. As I understand it, it's stacked layers, and the grades of gold between the layers is quite good. So again, there's an asset which has got real value, well in excess of the market cap. And I don't think it'll be long before we can get the drill turning there. And then to sort of complement this, you've got the Choco, which essentially is alluvials, platinum and gold. It's still a little bit of an operation, but it's ready again for some serious equipment to put in there for hopefully results which can generate a surplus of income and go towards the overheads of Colombia and hopefully cover the overheads of the company as well. So all in all, quite a basket full of assets, two of which can give that sort of growth and incremental return on capital that the retail investors are looking for. You know, big project, big returns.
Would you be looking to bring a partner into Choco, do you reckon? Would that be an option?
Very sensible, isn't it, when you think about it? In another part of my life, I've faced with alluvials, and alluvials are quite specific, you know. They're for the rough and ready guys, people who live in these difficult places, to live in rainforests and that. It's a particular expertise. You're often working in rivers, and it's indeterminate in as much as the grade is what you get at the end. You cannot really determine the grade. And sophisticated mining is all about, before you start spending money on capital, you determine the grade. And so it attracts the type of person who's prepared to live in these environments will recognize that the risk reward is quite great, but the reward can be immense. And there are quite a number of companies in Alaska and Africa and Southern America, South America, who are good at this alluvial mining. And so I'd be very surprised if we don't job out the risk and look for the benefit from a contract miner. And the company is having a number of approaches in that direction.
Very good, Colin. Plenty happening, of course. Quick word just before I let you go on Xtract Resources. So extended your collaboration there with Omnia Mining. Bring us up to date on what's happening with Xtract, Colin.
Oh, well, Xtract, of course, we're bedding down those alluvials. We've got three contracting companies. We've got the Chinese company, Sino Minerals. They're doing very well. And we've had some good results through February. Moz Gold, that's the South African, the kimberlite miners from South Africa. They basically have been ramping up their operation. They've shifted a lot of ground, exposed the alluvials, and they're parked out ready for treatment. And all their equipment in, and I'm expecting them to make some sort of a start in March, late March. So the reality is that we've been set back a bit by the rain, but nothing serious. We're generating, value on a daily, with cash generative on a daily and monthly basis, and I expect that cash to grow month on month significantly. And back to the collaboration agreement, that, you know, we've got that fair variety deposit, which is at a full DFS against it. We know what that's going to be, 35,000 ounces a year. We're currently talking to a number of groups about various forms of financing, or in actual fact, working with us on a royalty basis, not dissimilar from the alluvials. But, you know, there are lots and lots of that's fair variety. We've got quite a few, crops on our own, property, on the Manica property, which show quite significant tonnages at quite reasonable grades with changing metallurgy. Likewise, Omnia have got a use concession with lots of outcrops which haven't even been explored, and concealed outcrops, concealed subcrops, which we feel one or two of them are up to 2 or 3 kilometres. So our friends at Omnia have built a state-of-the-art, a really nice plant, which is the front end of a plant. It's crusher, secondary crusher, tertiary crusher, and ball mill. So with the gold, in situations where the gold is relatively free flowing, after a process system like that, we can recover the gold. And so what we've undertaken to do is bring our engineering into their property and carry out all the exploration at our cost, with a view to using their plant, and then we share, when we start the mine, we share 50-50. They throw in their plant, we throw in the exploration, we throw in our non-fairbride hard rocks, they throw in all of the hard rock, and that could lead to a pretty quick operation and quite meaningful gold production. So my plan there, you know, in Manica is to consolidate the area. There are other hard rock potentials as well. And we feel that we're the key player in the area. I think the local government recognise that too. And our shareholders are waiting. I know they're waiting for the results from the alluvials, but it's alluvials and hard rock, and it's we're on a fast track to consolidate the area. So as I say, just to summarise it all, we're increasing our earnings on a day-to-day basis at the alluvials. We're bedding down the alluvials. Three contractors. So we've got three outfits working for us. Our own level of risk is minimised to the 25% involvement we may or may not take by way of a convertible note. And I'm very happy with what's going on in Manica.
Colin, really good to catch up with you. Appreciate your time. Hope to see you in the studio at some point soon.
That'll be good. That'll be my pleasure. And thanks for this discussion. I appreciate the opportunity to update you and, of course, provide this podcast so our shareholders and would-be shareholders can understand what's going on in the company.